Welcome back, friends. Up till now, we have discussed under the topic for input tax credit all about what is input tax credit, when it is available, when it is not available, what are the conditions, documents required, etc. for availing input tax credit, right? So now we have to deal with a last and very important aspect of input tax credit. When a supplier is providing taxable as well as non-taxable or taxable as well as exempt product or services, then in that case, how input tax credit will be available? So before we discuss about the legal provisions of GST, let us discuss quickly one situation so that the logic or the thinking will be clear for us. Let us take a small example. Say there is a supplier, a vendor who is supplying only exempt goods or services, say for example. So on output side, we will say there is a supplier, say for example, and he is supplying only exempt services or goods. Obviously, there must be some kind of inputs also for his business, right? They might be taxable or exempt, whatever it may be. So on these inputs, whether he should be allowed to get input tax credit, where the input is taxable or exempt, he is getting ITC over here, but he is supplying exempt goods or services. So there is no output liability or output tax at all over here. So what your common sense or what your logic says is, since there is nothing to pay on output, right, he should not be allowed input tax credit, correct? That is a common sense, common logic. Now consider similar example that a person is supplying only taxable goods or services, let us say, and for that he may having some taxable or non-taxable inputs. So whether he should be allowed ITC on this? As per our logic, yes, he should be allowed input tax credit, because output tax is also chargeable. Output services or output supply is also chargeable. So he should be allowed. Now these two cases are quite easy to understand logically. Think a third case wherein a supplier is supplying two kind of services or goods. One is taxable and let us say another is non-taxable. Okay. And for this purpose, he is having various inputs which are common in nature. So whether he should be allowed input tax credit on supply of both taxable as well as exempt or non-taxable services. Now logically answer should be yes, he should be allowed, but only to the proportion of whatever he is supplying on which he is supposed to pay output tax, right? So if there is no tax on his supply, at least that proportionate amount it should be reduced from his input tax credit. This is something of common sense or our logic, right? So just based on this discussion, keep in mind, because the same concept, same logic, same common sense is applied in GST law also. What in short we can conclude is, if there is a one-to-one relationship between inputs and outputs, so if input is used directly for supply of output services or output of goods which is exempt, then there is no question of ITC. If inputs are used for supply of taxable services and goods, yes, then obviously there will be input tax credit available. And in case if inputs are used which are common for both taxable as well as non-taxable supplies, then we should do the proportionate calculation. The proportionate input tax credit relating to taxable supplies will be allowed, and those which is related to non-taxable supplies should not be allowed. This is just our common sense or logical discussion that we are doing, and same is actually mapped in the GST law also. But what are the detailed provisions? What are the requirements of this calculation? Let us try to understand one by one. Section 17 deals with such situation when ITC is available on proportionate basis, where goods or services are both, that is input side we are talking about, are used for both, partly for business and partly for other purpose, that is one part, and second, partly for effecting supply of taxable and zero rated supplies, and partly for exempt supplies. Now let us try to understand the first category. The first category is of where inputs are used for business and partly for other purpose, right? So say for example, there is a cloth merchant. He has purchased some cloth, obviously for the purpose of his business. Out of that, some of the cloth he is giving to needy people as a charity. Some of the cloth he is taking out for his home, say to gift his relatives, friends, etc. So this is something a non-business related purpose. So whether input tax credit will be allowed on this, obviously no, it will not be allowed. But then what is the question, what is the problem over here is, such inputs are not directly mapped to the outputs, right? It is not one to one. If it is one to one, okay, you have purchased one bundle of input and the same is used for non-business activity, then you will disallow that input tax credit. That is very simple. But if you have purchased one lot, one bundle, and out of that some portion you have used for business and some portion you have not used for business, then how much you should disallow, right? So section 17 deals with such kind of a situation, that is for business and for non-business purpose. So input tax credit proportionately for non-business purpose is to be disallowed. That is quite logical. We will see the formula how to calculate that. Whereas the second part is partly for effecting supply of taxable and zero rated supplies, that is on one side, and partly for exempt supplies. Now obviously goods which are used for effecting taxable supplies, they are 100% eligible for ITC, obviously subject to other conditions are fulfilled then only. And what is zero rated supplies? Zero rated supplies are nothing but exports or supplies to SEZ or SEZ units. So these are special category of supplies, we can say, on which the tax is zero. You are not paying any output tax, right? But government want to promote this. Government want to incentivize exports and supplies to this kind of a indirect way of exports like SEZ, correct? So with that intention, the input tax credit proportionate to zero rated supplies is also allowed by government. This is the logic that we are discussing behind the provision. So on one hand, we are considering taxable and zero rated supplies, which will be eligible for 100% input tax credit for whatever inputs they are using, and exempt supplies. Now again, as per our discussion, if there was one to one relationship between input directly used for exempt supply, then it is very simple, it will be disallowed. But if there are common inputs that are used for making taxable supplies as well as exempt supplies, then section 17 proportionate input tax credit you have to follow. So how to calculate this proportionately? What is the methodology mentioned in rule 42 and 43? Let us now discuss. Before discussing the calculation logic, we have to be clear about what is the meaning of exempt supply for this purpose of section 17. Exempt supply, as per the normal terminology, is the supply on which no tax is to be payable, that is zero tax or nil rate of tax, or if it is exempt under notification, it is non-taxable, right? These are all covered under the definition of exempt supplies, correct? But for the purpose of this section, what all is included in the calculation of exempt supply is also mentioned under section 17. So let us see one by one what all is included. First, for supplier, it means from supplier's point of view, we are talking about supply on which recipient is to pay under RCM, that is reverse charge mechanism. So from supplier's point of view, if he is supplying something and on that the recipient is supposed to pay under RCM, then it is a way of exempt supply for him only. He is not paying any tax on it. But that should be calculated in the calculation of exempt supply. So say for example, Mr. A is supplying GTA, that is goods and transport agency services. He is a transport operator, let us say, on which receiver has to pay under RCM, right? For GTA services, the receiver has to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism as per the notification of government. So from the point of view of Mr. A, when he is calculating the exempt supplies, he will include this particular supply because on this he is not paying the tax, but the receiver is paying tax. So in calculation of exempt supplies, Mr. A will include this turnover. Very logical. Second, transaction in securities taken at 1% of the sale value of such securities. So if there is any supplier and he is dealing in securities, if you remember, then we have discussed that the definition of goods as well as services do not cover securities, like dealing in shares, buying and selling the shares on listed stock exchanges, listed securities. So on that there is no GST. But for the purpose of calculation of exempt supply, these transaction in securities has to be calculated at 1% of sale value. So say for example, Mr. A had sold securities at rupees 5 lakh rupees, right? So while calculating the exempt supplies, we should consider 1% of 5 lakh, that is equal to 5000 rupees, will be treated as exempt supply by Mr. A, right? So Mr. A is doing some kind of a consultancy services. Let us take an example that he is doing a consultancy services, providing consultancy services which is taxable, and he is having some surplus amount which he has invested in securities, shares, that he sold afterwards when he required some funds, right? So when he sells these shares, he sold it for rupees 5 lakh, but only 1% of that, that is 5000, will be included in the value of exempt supplies for calculating proportionate amount of ITC that should be disallowed for Mr. A. Next one is sale of land taken at the same as adopted for the purpose of paying stamp duty. So as you are aware, when you buy and sell land, building, etc., then you have to pay stamp duty, and for that stamp duty purpose, a ready reckoner valuation is a different one given by government authorities. That value or actual consideration, which we should consider, the act says, GST act says, the value which is adopted for the purpose of stamp duty. It means on what amount you are paying stamp duty, take the same amount for this purpose. So say for example, Mr. A sold land for rupees 5 lakh rupees and value for stamp duty purpose is rupees 7 lakh rupees. Then the value for stamp duty purpose, that is 7 lakh rupees, will be included in value of exempt supply. Similar provision is for sale of, see the last calculation, last point, sale of completed building on which GST is not applicable. Under the schedule for GST, it is mentioned that when the construction is complete, the occupation certificate, completion certificate is given, and then if a builder is selling a flat or a house, right, in that case the GST is not applicable. So sale after receipt of occupancy certificate or after first occupation, value shall be same as adopted for stamp duty, exactly same what we discussed for land. So if Mr. A sold house for rupees 50 lakh, after its occupation he is selling the goods for 50 lakh, but value for stamp duty is 70 lakh. So for the purpose of calculation of ITC, which is disallowed under section 17 for Mr. A, the value of exempt supplies will not be considered 50 lakh, but it should be considered value for stamp duty rupees 70 lakh. So 70 lakh will be included in the value of exempted services of A. Now similarly, there are few exclusions from exempt supply. Let us see one by one what is all excluded. Excise duty levied under entry 84 of list 1 or entry 51 of list 2 of 7 schedule of constitution, that is excise duty, VAT on sale of goods, supply of services to Nepal, Bhutan against rupee convert, Indian rupee covered under notification 42. So if there is supply of services, then it should not be included in the value of exempt supplies. Interest discount received on deposits, loans, etc. Even these are exempt, right? As per the notification, these are exempt, but these are not to be included in calculating exempt supplies. Like say for example, there is a person who is having some excess funds. He has kept that amount in bank fixed deposit. On that he is receiving interest. So that interest amount received is not to be included in the value of exempt supplies. And lastly, services by transport of goods by vessel from custom station to place outside India. It is in the part of exports. It should not be considered in the value of exempt supplies. Right? So now keep this discussion in mind and we will see what is the process of calculation, how it is calculated, the ITC on proportionate basis under section 70.